What's a better nasal spray, Sterimar or Povidone-iodine? Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Hi, Linda.
Hey, how are you?
What's your question today?
I read your updated food and supplement guide for coronavirus. I actually have a pretty serious autoimmune condition that we're treating with, of course, an immunosuppressant drug, which puts me at probably the highest risk level.
Right.
So my question is, I'm just following all the highest risk stuff that you have in here. I'm a little nervous about the povidone iodine. I'm a nursing home administrator, so I get most of this, but that makes me just a little bit nervous. So I ordered the Sterimar, and I was going to do that. Do you think that would be just as helpful?
It's hard to say. So the povidone iodine obviously has some contraindications. And it has contraindications mostly because it's been so commonly used in a medical setting and therefore has so much known about its safety and risk profile. And so I don't have any particular reason. Oh, hi, Lynn, and now we can see you. So I don't have any particular reason to think that the Sterimar is unsafe in any context. And I used it a lot. The only thing I can say anecdotally is I've used the povidone iodine intranasally and I've used the Sterimar spray intranasally. And I feel like 0.5% povidone iodine is really powerful in wiping out anything weird going on in the nose. I was actually very surprised when I started using it how powerful it was. So one thing that happened was I was inside a U-Haul truck, and you would think, like, I don't know what happened that made me start sneezing, but either it was, I don't know if it was dust or if it was allergies, but you know, you're sharing U-Haul trucks, and if you're moving, you're going to be inside the U-Haul truck, right? And so you can imagine that someone may have been using the U-Haul truck an hour before I was using it. They may have, you know, done some coughing and sneezing while they're inside the U-Haul truck. And if so, there could be aerosols from who knows what inside the U-Haul truck. So it's possible that just walking in and out of the U-Haul truck got me sick. And you know, whether it was COVID-19 or whether it was a cold or whatever it was, all I know is that I started using the povidone iodine I think one of the products I linked to in the guide is a neti pot modeled bottle. And so it's like a plastic bottle. That has a little valve on the other end, and you just stick it in your nose, bend your head over the sink a little bit, and just the tiniest, I actually felt like it was hard to not get more than I needed. So just tap the valve like a tiny bit, and then that would stop me from sneezing for the next 4 hours. And I was real surprised by that because in the modeling that they've done of how long it lasts in the nose, seems like the modeling suggests it only stays there for about 10 minutes. But you have to remember that, you know, in that 10 minutes, it might cause a dramatic kill off of what's there. And then there's a little population left. So the iodine is gone. But now that the viral growth is restarting from scratch. Right. In my personal use of the Sterimar spray, I feel like it has that effect, but it's tremendously less powerful. And it also has an effect that lasts a couple hours. But the other thing is that the Sterimar spray also makes my nose a little runny for about 5 minutes. And I think that's not a negative effect. It's just a side effect. So my book, to answer your question, I think the Sterimar spray is a good backup to the povidone iodine. If you have any safety concerns about the povidone-iodine, then I would definitely use the Sterimar spray instead. But I would expect a benefit, but a less powerful one from it.
Okay. And then I was reading, I got some of the povidone-iodine, reading how to make the dilution. So I got the 10%, the bottle you had linked to. And then I just take like a teaspoon of that and then add 19 teaspoons of water.
Yeah, exactly. So you could do it by volume or you could do it by weight. I have a food scale, and so that goes into ounces or grams. So I personally found it easiest to do the math on a food scale with the gram setting. So I had a precise thing, but yeah, you could absolutely, if you don't have a food scale, you could absolutely use teaspoons. It's just, you know, one part to 19 parts. 19 okay. parts is the water. One part is the right.
And does any kind of water, just sterile, just...
Well, you know, what they recommend doing in the literature is to use, like, sterile water. But that iodine is probably going to sterilize whatever that water is. You know, so if it's water that you would be comfortable drinking, then it's probably water that's going to be fine if it swishes through your nose. And keep in mind, you know, people go into pools, people go into oceans, like getting water into your nose isn't that big of a deal, particularly if it's with something that is a powerful sanitizer, in my opinion.
And then it also says spray some in your mouth and swish it for 60 seconds.
Yeah, so I actually haven't been doing that because by the time I started using it, I've considered myself in a really low risk situation. And so I just felt like if I have symptoms in my nose and they're killed for 4 hours completely with a little drop in the nose, why bother going and doing more than that? But I think if you're in a situation where you really consider the risk of catching something to be much greater than the pain in the butt required to swish and gargle and stuff like that, then And I just borrowed what's there from a protocol. I forget which one it was. There was two different protocols from some big hospitals. They are listed in the detailed section referenced. One gave a volume of 9 milliliters. One gave a volume of 10 milliliters. One said just to do an oropharyngeal rinse. The other specified to gargle, swish 30 seconds, gargle 30 seconds. And so in version 4 and 4.1, I got a lot of questions like, well, how much, you know, what volume do we use? Do we really have to gargle for 60 seconds? So I just figured I'd be as detailed as possible in this one.
Okay, good. Well, I think that's it for now. I'll refresh myself a little bit here. And then, you know, if I have any other questions and you have time, I'll raise my hand again.
Awesome. Thank you, Linda. Thank you so much.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. As a bonus, you also get to participate in monthly private Zoom Q&As with me. You can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled out as Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for a 10% lifetime discount. For the remainder of 2020, I will be working full-time on finishing my Vitamins and Minerals 101 book while reserving a portion of my time for consulting clients. You can pre-order my book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. I will try to respond to comments here when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.